How's everybody? Good to see you all. I would have to echo everything that you've heard this evening about Joe's character. I know a lot of you know Joe personally, and he truly is one of the world's great humans. Musicians are an interesting lot, you know. You may know a few. To work with someone who is so deeply gentlemanly and someone who really, well, I should tell you that Joe and I started working together about 13 years ago, I think it was. And I just felt instantly, I knew that I was going to be playing with a legend because I too had an album that said Joe Durang's Jig on it. And it was one of the first traditional Irish music albums that I ever got. I came late to the music, I was about 20 years old, and I thought, it was time to kind of dig into this music. I was beginning to get interested in what bits that I heard. And do you remember record stores back in the old days? There was this marvelous place where you could spend hours just thumbing through the bins, and there were liner notes. And I remember picking up this album by someone named Andy McGann. I said, this is probably a good place to start. No relation, evidently. And I took the album home, and I tried to learn most of the tunes, and I noticed that there was a Joe Durang's Jig, and then somewhere else, as I was beginning to learn about the music, I read that there was a guy named Joe Durang, legendary accordion player from Boston. So, wow, okay, but, then I learned the tune, which was, should I play it for Joe? He said, no, that's evidently it's called A Bit of Ginger. But there's another one that went on the pile of Joe Durang jigs that aren't. But somehow Joe and I found each other about 1998. We started to play together, and I had been playing Irish music for a good maybe 20 or some years. It's still just a pub, but there were so many elements of Joe's music that caught me. Things that I recognized from the other kinds of music that I played, because I had some experience in jazz and popular music. And I just wanted to talk about, I don't want to keep you too long, I know it's not a music class, but I wanted to just explain a couple of things that I found in Joe's playing that were really useful to me. There's a lot of talk about Joe as an accordion player, but to me, he's a musician who plays the accordion, and there's a big distinction between instrument operators and musicians, if you know what I mean. Joe is a real musician who happens to play the accordion. So one of the first things that I learned from Joe, I saved all of the set lists of every gig that we've ever done. And I went back to the earliest one today, and I saw it back from 98, the first set of tunes that we played together. I think we're going to actually play later on this set of tunes, the Old Copper Plate. And it was a tune that I had an acquaintance with. I had sort of learned it in the way that you would learn it in a session. You all know about Irish sessions, and people playing together in settings like that, we don't have as much individuality happening in those settings where we're playing. It becomes a kind of a group organism. And the way that we play the tunes, we tend to play tend to play versions of tunes that are maybe a little bit more boiled down and straightforward than we would play if we were playing individually. Well, in playing with Joe and Seamus Conley as well, playing together in a setting like that, the individuality of the players in the duo setting can come out quite a bit more. So anyway, I listened to a live recording of us playing this tune called The Old Copper Plate, and I noticed that Joe had a little passage that went, the normal passage would be played pretty simple, and Joe had gone, there's this one little note in the middle. This is the thing that Earl's referring to before as chromaticism. And it just means that you're playing notes that are as close together as possible. If I played a fully chromatic thing, that's just all the notes put together. So there's little snippets of the chromatic scale that Joe would use. I've never heard anyone else in traditional Irish music do this before or since, actually. Now, in particular, this is happening in a tune that's in a minor key. If I were to stop short on that note, it would convert the entire the mastery is in using that note in just the right way, passing through it, resolving out of it, giving this great lift to the tune, and just these little details, as they say, God is in the details, these little details that you can find by studying the music of master players like Joe, do so much for you as a musician. So that's just one little thing that I wanted to, you know, share with you. There's also some things that he's done in tunes, for example, in there's a wonderful jig that I learned from Joe called the White Petticoat. And I want to actually play it for you. I'm just going to lilt it for you. The usual jig rhythm. It's going da 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 da. So if we were to count it, it would feel like we're playing three attacks against the beat. Ba 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 ba. Da 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 da. Be the normal way to play it. Joe has some passages that he plays in this tune. And really what's going on is like the feeling of 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, maybe a single file marching along. And all of a sudden you've got the wise guy going, it's wonderful, it's brilliant, and it's funny. I think it, I'm glad that it made you laugh, because it does, you know, it had the same effect on me. I was like, that is so cool, it's so unusual. Yet there's something to it. All of these things to me do not sound like they're outside of the tradition. They have a way, he has a way of making them work in the tradition that don't seem like they're some kind of hybrid or Frankenstein kind of effect. They just have a natural musical flow. And to do that, the art of being able to work in these things and keep the purity of the music going, I think is one of the real hallmarks of Joe's playing. He doesn't like the word genius. It's one of the great elements of craftsmanship. Is that okay? Yeah. In Joe's playing. This idea of personalizing the tunes and being able to bring personality to it, I think it's a wonderful thing. I know that there are some, there's at least one traditional musician who's rather loud about the fact that maybe CDs have done something to music that is not good. But I think having recordings is a wonderful thing. When you have one person recording, or you know, one person with an accompanist, you can really hear what that individual was about. I love band playing, I love playing in sessions, but I also really like to get the chance to hear a solo musician, whether it's a solo fiddle or, you know, accordion, maybe with a piano. But you can really hear what a person can do with the tunes. And Joe's really exemplary of someone who has taken this music, which can be thought of as being really largely group music when you think of the dance music. I don't think a lot of times it's necessarily a solo musician playing. It's usually, I think of bands and, you know, bigger groups or from trios on up. This idea of being able to really hear somebody mining these tunes for all their worth is a wonderful thing. So I would say that basically the future is now, if you think about it, when you think of the future of traditional music. Just a couple of other musical points that I wanted to mention. Beyond, when you think of traditional music, we usually think of melody being the forefront of the music. Somebody goes, well, you don't ever whistle the chords. But the chords are important, the harmony is important, and the harmony leads a composer, awareness of chords, leads someone who's writing tunes to some new places that they may not have thought of otherwise. And in tunes like Tango de Rain, which is a wonderful tune off of the Grove Lane CD, Joe's using both augmented chords, a normal major chord that we all know and love, a minor chord, an augmented chord is another beast altogether. And played by itself, you would think, you're not right, a tune around that. It's got a real dissonance to it. But used in passing, the way Joe would do this, and even on tunes that aren't his own tunes, but within the tradition, in his accompaniment playing on the buttons, on the box, working in these kind of lines, awareness of the bass lines, awareness of the inside of the chord, all of this really does transcend a bit of what most musicians within the tradition would be thinking of. Brings this extra dimension to the music, I think. So just wanted to kind of point that out. To For those of you who aren't musicians, I'm so sorry to be getting technical, but I am a professor of music after all, so I had to offer those things. And lastly, I just wanted to say that it would raise the question among some, but is it traditional? And it made me think of the great Duke Ellington quote where he said, there's only two kinds of music, good and bad. And I think that Joe has given us, I don't want to say how many years of really great music. And let's hear it from him and keeping the music going. I know that he's still writing and there are many more great tunes.